Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our worship today as we pray for our Lord's blessings on our worship together. For our service, we'll follow setting number 3. We open with the singing of hymn 566.
Thank you.
Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
I said, I'll confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and we have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who has given your only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake, grant us remission of all our sins. And by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To those who believe on his name, he gives the power to become the children of God and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all.
Amen.
Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain. For the Lord our God is holy. The Lord reigns, let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion, he is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name.
Holy is he.
The king in his might loves justice.
You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Judah.
Exalt the Lord our God, worship at his footstool.
Holy is he. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain. Glory be to God on high,
and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee. We glorify thee, we give thanks to thee. Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O God, in the glorious transfiguration of your beloved Son, you confirm the mysteries of the faith by the testimony of Moses and Elijah. In the voice that came from the bright cloud, you wonderfully foreshadowed our adoption by grace. Mercifully make us co-heirs with the King in his glory, and bring us to the fullness of our inheritance in heaven. The same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our Old Testament reading is from the second chapter of 2 Kings, starting with the first verse. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elijah were on their way from Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elijah, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elijah said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. And the sons of the prophets who were at Bethel came out to Elijah and said to him, "Do you not know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he said, "Yes, I know it. Keep quiet." And Elijah said to him, "Elijah, please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho, and the sons of the prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elijah and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know it. Keep quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the sons of the prophets also went and stood at some distance from them as they were both standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his cloak and rolled it up and struck the water. And the water was parted to one side and to the other, till the two of them could go over on dry ground. When they crossed, Elijah said to Elijah, "Ask, what shall I do for you before I am taken from you?" And Elijah said, "Please, let there be a double portion of your spirit on me." And he said, "You've asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken from you, it shall be so for you. But if you do not see me, it will not be so." And they went still went on and talked. And behold, chariots of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elijah saw it, and he cried, my father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." And he saw him no more. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise the Lord, all nations.
Extol him, all peoples.
For great is the steadfast love toward us. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name.
Bring an offering and come to his courts.
Our epistle lesson is from the third and fourth chapters of Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, starting with the 12th verse and continuing on to chapter 4, the 6th. "Since we have such a hope, we are very bold. Not like Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the Israelites might not gaze at the outcome of what was being brought to an end. But their minds was hardened. For to this day, when they read the old covenant, that same veil remains unlifted, because only through Christ is it taken away. Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. For when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. But we have renounced disgraceful, underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled only to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. You are the most handsome of the sons of men. Grace is poured upon your lips. Alleluia.
Suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them but Jesus only. As they were coming down the mountain, he charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, this Sunday, as we celebrate the Feast of Transfiguration, the season of Epiphany comes to an end, along with the time of Christmas, since the two are connected. So in that light, we'll begin today with these words, familiar as they are. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. Hail the incarnate deity. These words from Wesley's Hark the Herald Angels Sing highlight the great theme that goes from Christmas to Transfiguration. That is the incarnation of the only Son of God as the second person of the Trinity, as he takes on a human nature, as he becomes not only true God, but true man. From that time on, Jesus reveals himself. He slowly reveals himself through his ministry, through his life, throughout his passion, his death, and his resurrection, and continues to reveal himself in the ministry of the church even today. But the glory of God remains hidden, hidden in the physical realm, except to those baptized in the sacramental waters and who are fed with the very body and blood of Christ. You see, what the world sees is very different from what you and I see. As the world beholds the veiled nature of God, the believer sees beyond the veil with eyes of faith and beholds the hidden nature of God. And while glimpses of his divine nature come through in his teachings, in his preaching, in his healing of the sick, casting out of demons, raising the dead, three of his disciples are treated with a vision that far surpasses the rest. 6 days after Peter's confession of Jesus as the Christ, the Son of the living God, our Lord takes Peter, James, and John up on a mountain by themselves. And suddenly we're told Jesus was transfigured before them. His clothing becomes radiant, intensely white as no one on earth could bleach them. And to further solidify the reality of what they're seeing, Peter wrote in the second Peter, first chapter, we were the eyewitnesses to his divine majesty. What Peter, what James, what John witnessed was the divine nature of Jesus shining through, unveiled in his human flesh. Unveiled in flesh, the Godhead see. More was revealed in Jesus' unveiled state as Elijah appears to them along with Moses. Those Old Testament giants stand there talking with Jesus in his transfigured state. And out of sheer terror, not knowing what to say, Peter speaks out his famous words, Rabbi, it's good that we're here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Mark relates for us what's really going on, that Peter just couldn't keep quiet. As he did so many times in the past, he spoke up, not knowing what to say, and kind of puts his foot in his mouth. I think we're familiar with that. Peter just couldn't keep quiet. But neither could someone else. There was someone else who had to speak out at this moment. And a voice boomed from the cloud saying, this is my beloved son. Listen to him. Without a doubt, Peter, James, and John recognized this as the voice of God the Father, as he had made himself known so many times in the past before. And when the voice was done speaking, suddenly all is quiet. It's all silent once more. All is as it was. The clock had struck midnight, and the moment was past. No more shining clothes. No more Elijah. No more Moses. No more divine cloud. The veil was back in place. And rightly so. Because this was not to be a permanent change for Jesus at this time. And the chosen three were not to tell anyone about this amazing event until after Jesus' resurrection from the dead, which they still had a hard time understanding and believing in. They still didn't really think that would actually occur. But these men were permitted to catch a glimpse of Jesus' divine nature and to hear God's word of approval on this Jesus, their teacher. But now that's it. Jesus was back to normal, at least normal for Jesus, and he resumes his ministry right away as they come down from the mountaintop and he's confronted with a demonic possession that required his great power. And he continued to use that great power to bring the kingdom of heaven near to the people, because he knew full well that man cannot draw near to the kingdom on his own. We cannot do it. It must be brought to us. So Jesus' divine nature, his great power of the Son of God, remains veiled. Veiled to those around him. You see, there is a veil that surrounds us, that surrounds this whole world. Our sinfulness is like a veil, that sinful nature that is still within. It darkens everything for us. Because of sin, the most amazing moment you can experience in this life is tinged with the knowledge it can't last forever. Your greatest successes are not as lustrous because many times the steps we take to get there are not as holy as they should have been. Man's corrupted nature, his broken state, keeps some from ever seeing their children and grandchildren from ever growing up. Plenty of food on the table one day, followed by crumbs to scrounge the next. Friendships can seemingly end overnight. Reputations can degrade from sweet to sour to terrible. The forgiveness you receive in the words of absolution are sometimes forgotten by lunchtime. Sometimes they're forgotten before we leave the building. Let's face it. The consumption of the body and blood of Jesus sometimes replaced at concerns of where we're going for lunch next. Assurances of life everlasting, forgiveness of sins, salvation can quickly disappear into the past. Peter, James, and John had to descend the Mount of Transfiguration. They had seen with their own eyes the astonishing truth of Jesus' identity as the second person of the Trinity. In their own flesh, they had seen it with their own eyes. But that spiritual high was now over. And it was back down to the dark, hurtful, sinful world below. Jesus had revealed his glory to them, but had hidden it once more. Can you imagine the thoughts going through their head? What can we do? What can we do to get him to reveal that glory to us once more? To do it again. How can we see that miraculous sight? How can we make things right in our own lives? How can we make the good times last and the terrible ones disappear? See, the answer to our questions is the answer to the disciples' questions. See, Jesus, in his hidden form, would unashamedly and unexpectedly reveal his glory once more on the cross. Only this time what was revealed about the Holy God was his steadfast love, his total compassion for his people. The Eternal Father, strong to save, put his only begotten Son under the outstretched arms of the cross. Hammer and nail drove through the human flesh of God. Such crude tools were used to spill forth the glory of God in Jesus once more, as the very lifeblood of our God spills forth onto the earth. You see, the wounds in Jesus' flesh, those wounds were openings in the veil of his majesty, allowing his glory to shine forth. With a spear that pierces his side, both water and blood flow from Jesus, the Son of God. And those great liquids splash upon the earth, crossing over all time and space, as the water fills each baptismal font, as the body and blood each communion supper. Though seen as only humble water and humble wine and bread by the unbelieving world around us, through eyes of faith given to us through the word of Christ, we see the word of God. We see it in, with, and under the bread, the wine, and the water, and the holy sacraments. See, you and I will leave this sanctuary once more on this Transfiguration Sunday and turn to our normal God-given lives. The precious of these moments of hearing the word of Jesus' transfiguration, it'll dissolve into a fog. Doubt me? How about if I gave you a quiz on what was last week's sermon? Trust me, I don't remember it either. But it will dissolve away as we enter our sin-filled world once more. Hopelessness, despair, frustration, anger will accompany each and every sin that is born in our sinful hearts once more. But that doesn't change a truth we have that the unbelieving world doesn't. That every time you hear the word of the gospel, every time you read it in your personal devotions, in your Bible study, in your prayers, each time you come back here to this place to receive the absolution, the forgiveness of God from the pastor as from God himself, each time you eat and drink the body and blood of Jesus, each time you celebrate the transfiguration of Jesus, the veil's removed. And once again, you see his glory bright and clear, even as you receive the forgiveness of your sins and the salvation of your souls. For God has given these gifts to you, his word, his sacraments, to keep you in the true faith and to life everlasting. For he wants you to be with him forever. And until that last great day, you have those gifts. They're yours every day, until that day when you and I will behold Jesus face to face, when unveiled in flesh, the Godhead you shall see, not only then, but you'll see it for all eternity. Amen. And may God's peace, that surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Please rise. Let us rise to prayer. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. O Holy Father, with the appearance of Moses and Elijah at our Lord's glorious Transfiguration, you reveal to us that the law and the prophets are fulfilled in him. Send your blessing upon all pastors and servants of your church. Their preaching and teaching would flow from his right understanding of Christ and his work for our eternal salvation. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, grant faithfulness, humility, and patience to the sheep of your flock here at Zion. That in our various vocations we may strive to love you and our neighbor in all that we say and do. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, bless the families of your church. Parents would teach the faith to their children. The forgiveness of sins be proclaimed in all households. Remember all expectant mothers, that they and their babies be kept safe and healthy throughout their pregnancies and lives. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty Father, you alone establish all authority on earth. Bless those entrusted with this responsibility, both here and abroad, that they would serve with integrity and honor for the well-being of all. Lord, in your mercy. O God of all grace, look with compassion upon those who are in need. We especially lift up before you Craig, Timothy, James, Danny, Jim, and John, Coy, Kathy, Darlene, and Joanne, Ruby, Ron, Bob, Cliff, Kim, and Eddie, Pat, Ruth, Elma, Sue, and Alex, and those we lift up before you in our hearts. O Lord, grant them relief and comfort through the promise of sharing in the eternal glory with Christ for all your children. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, you revealed your glory in the transfiguration of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who tabernacled among us in the flesh. Open our eyes that by faith we would see him continuing to tabernacle among us here in the divine service. Grant that we would heed your admonition to listen to him, as he forgives and preserves us at the font, the pulpit, and the altar. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we gratefully remember on this day the glorious manifestation of your Son's divinity on the Mount of Transfiguration. Teach us to listen to Jesus, ever to fix our eyes on him and his innocent suffering and death for our forgiveness. By your grace and mercy, strengthen us to remain faithful in all circumstances of trial, temptation, and persecution. Preserve us to the end, that we may die a blessed death, believing in your beloved Son, with whom you are well pleased, the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Once again, good morning, and I'd like to ask, are there any announcements that need to be made? I remind you that we will begin our Festival of Lent with an Ash Wednesday service this Wednesday at 7 o'clock. I presume it's 7 o'clock because I think all Lutheran services in the midweek are 7 o'clock, right? I know there's no meal beforehand. They warned me about that. But they mentioned that after the service, there's often a Bible study. Does that begin Ash Wednesday or the following week? Following week. Okay. Well, since it's also Valentine's Day, that's probably a good thing. Let us go forth in our Lord's grace to serve him.